with us and Harold. So, Jacques, you're with us. So, good morning, everyone. Boker Tov. Before we start Rav Shai's shiur, we just wanted to share with you that we met Phil, Harold, and Jacques together to plan the ongoing shiurim, and we wanted to share with you that we've decided that there'll be continuous shiurim throughout the summer. We will not have a summer break. We value the importance of our weekly shiurim opportunity to be learning, and therefore we'll have continuous shiurim on Thursdays. So I know the summer holidays, and we've got a captured audience. So Baruch Hashem, we're happy to offer you ongoing high quality shiurim throughout the summer on Thursdays. So when you do plan with your family, your children and grandchildren, Thursdays are kadosh for ongoing learning in the mornings, together with the Beit Midrash Boker, with Nitzanim, and with Torah Mitzion. So we are approaching the Rabbanim to put a schedule together, and we'll share that with you. So that's the good news, and hopefully that we'll have Kiddush Hashem of ongoing learning throughout the summer. We also like to reach out again that we Baruch Hashem turn to our learners to be partners with us and to please consider sponsoring a weekly learning or being a stakeholder in this wonderful program as we are towards the end of our seventh very successful year of learning together. So we're going to paste on the chat at the moment the link to JGive's site, especially for this learning. So if you click on it, you can go in directly and choose to sponsor Shiur and donate online. Yes, we do need donations. We are still behind. We did cut back. As you know, we don't have the wonderful breakfast. I know it's on the house, as I say, it's everyone's home enjoying the breakfast, but we are still haven't completed the fundraising for this year. And now that we have the summer, obviously we're going to need to return to our regular donors and to all those that have not yet sponsored to please consider sponsoring the learning so that we can ensure the ongoing program. And also there's a phone number to the office. You could also call up the office. And we know in the past, certain people at the breakfast will give us a check. So if you feel that that's the best way, it's best to mail it or to just call the office and we can allow for your donation and we'll take the details. So please follow the link, call us up. And Bezrat Hashem, we carrying on successful learning. We're very proud of this project. Rav Shai, the Rav of Nitzanim, and our star, Magid Shiur, all of us together with Phil, with Jacques, with Harold, and all of you have ensured that this has become a well-known Makom Torah and carry on learning together. So without further ado, Kvod Rav Shai, and thank you very much and continue partnering with us. Bahatzlacha to kol everyone and Shabbat Shalom and Chodesh Tov and Kol Tov.
Thank you, Zevi. I will just say
sorry, one more thing, because it's all on Zoom, you please invite friends and family to join, send us their detail and we'll add them to the list. We obviously want to share and know who's learning, so recommend people to join, and also we are taping the shiurim. There is the database where you could, if you missed a shiur, it's all on the Torah Mitzion site. You can access the previous shiurim. But please suggest to family and friends, especially now through the summer, ongoing summer program through this through the learning. So, Ba'atzlacha. Toda Rav Shai. Toda.
Thank you, Zevika. I will just say one thing. You said that's the seventh year and very successful years, and I hope it's not Sheva Shnei Asova and then God forbid Shnei Ra'av. I think it should be exactly the opposite. The 7 years was Sheva Shnei Ra'av, and now Bezrat Hashem will have Sheva Shnei Sova. So I think that's probably what you meant. So I'm just clarified your statement. But really, I think it's such a worthy cause, such a beautiful thing to do. You know, when we came back almost 4 years ago, Bezrat Hashem, this summer, you know, you always try to continue your shtichut. If it's not in Memphis, it can be somewhere else. But to see Torah Mitzion flourishing in Israel, it's definitely something that it's very important. So hopefully you will all join Zevik's request. I call him Zevik. What can I do? That's the way I know Zevi. I know Zev, and that's the way I'm going to call him until 120. Okay, so we are going to learn today. What I want to do today is to really to focus on two main themes in the parsha that will be obviously interconnected when we will finish the class. But there are two main issues. Is A, it's more chronological or technical, which is what is exactly the date that Miriam passed away and what does it mean to us? Meaning not only the technical issue of, you know, if that was Zayin Be'av, Tet Be'av, Yud Gimel Be'av, that's not my concern so much, but I want to understand the context. That's A. And B, to try to deal with the issue of the transmission and the transformation between the generations, which obviously happens, especially in our parsha, and I think has tremendous lessons to us, really very relevant to us. So I will share a screen, obviously, and we will start the shiur. Okay, so here we go. Okay. So first question that we're going to have is Matai niftera Miriam u'mashma'ut smichut ha-parshiyot. So the Torah says, Vayavo bnei Yisrael kol ha'eda midbar tzin b'chodesh ha-rishon v'yeshev ha'am b'kadesh v'atamot sham Miriam v'tikaver sham. So all the Jewish people, bnei Yisrael kol ha'eda, which obviously we'll need to understand what does that mean, kol ha'eda. Obviously kol ha'eda, what you think, only part of the eda, only part of the congregation, it's everyone. Midbar tzin, בחודש הראשון, וישב העם בקדש, and the people sat in קדש, ותמות שם מרים ותיקבר שם. So obviously this first pasuk has some things that we need to look at. Look at, there are three names for the Jewish people. We have בני ישראל, we have כל העדה, and then we have העם. Three names for the same, basically for the same thing. It's the people. So obviously we need to try to understand, and that's what we'll see, that the Mefarshim were obviously trying to figure out what does it mean, that we have three references to the Jewish people. Bnei Israel, Kol Ha'eda, and Ha'am. So that's one. That's one thing that we need to understand. B, we need to understand a little bit, where is Kadesh? We know that Kadesh, that was the place that they sent the Meraglim, Kadesh Barnea. Is that the same place? Well, they didn't move. It seems to be that they did move. So what does that mean? And then, which is really the most important thing for me, look at how dry is the description. Vatamot sham Miriam, vatikaver sham. Miriam passed away, she died, and she was buried there. Like nothing. That's it. She lived, she died, she was buried. Let's go home. And it seems to be so insensitive to some extent. You know, doesn't say that Miriam was Aaron and Moshe's sister. Doesn't say that, you know, because of her, we had all sorts of miracles. Nothing. She was just, she died and she was buried. And obviously, all those questions, we will deal with all of them, or at least with most of them, when we go further. But until now, everyone understand my issues with the Pasuk? Just nod your head. Okay. So first and foremost, Rashi says, Kol ha'eda, עדה השלימה שכבר מתו מתי מדבר ואלו פרשו לחיים. So Rashi immediately gives us a little bit the timing. When we talk about ויבואו בני ישראל כל העדה, it means all the עדה that was chosen to live after the Meraglim, which means everyone who was born in the desert and everyone who was under 20 when they left Mitzrayim. Which means kol ha'eda, the entirety of the congregation, means that what? That now we are really talking about the new generation. the generation that left Mitzrayim are already kulam, everyone is dead, besides whom? Yehoshua and Caleb. And if you remember my class about Shlach Lecha, Caleb was chosen because he stood up with Ruach Acheret, with a new spirit, and that was Caleb, and Yehoshua was chosen to survive the Meraglim only because he was chosen to be Moshe's replacement, substitute, but not because he did anything special with the Meraglim. V'tamot sham Miriam, so says Rashi, Lama nismecha parashat mitat Miriam leparashat para aduma? Why is it that mitat Miriam, the death of Miriam, was dafka specifically in our parasha that talks about para aduma? That's the beginning of parashat Chukat. Lomar lecha ma korbanot mechaprim af mitat tzadikim mechaperet. It's come to teach you that like sacrifices atone, so too the death of a tzaddik. But now I want to ask you a question before we go further. What chet are we talking about? What transgression are we talking about that Miriam needs to atone for? Para aduma, I understand. There is tumat met, there is the impurity of a dead body. So you mazeh, you take the water, you sprinkle it, you do the afar. That, I understand it. But what does it mean that Miriam, from here we learn that when a tzaddik dies, he atones for the sins of everyone, which, by the way, I'm not going to deal with it right now. It has a little bit of a Christian taste. You know, when someone else dies, you know, we are being atoned for someone else's death. I'm not dealing with that at all now from the theological perspective. I want to deal with just the issue of what transgression are we talking about? What is Miriam come to atone? You know what? We'll put it like that, like in Hebrew. Ma siti achshav? What did I do now that you need to atone for me? What do you think is the chet that we are talking about? I hope you had your breakfast. Wake up. If you need to talk, you need to unmute yourself.
When she was gossiping with Aaron about Moshe, complaining about him.
Okay, so Fagi was the first one to wake up. Thank you, Fagi. And you basically says, you know what? I am going to attach this death of Miriam to end of Parashat Be'alotcha. At the end of Parashat Be'alotcha, we saw that that Miriam and Aaron spoke about Moshe, and that's the sin that she did, and that's what she needs to atone for. The issue with Fagi's statement is, I thought that Miriam was already punished. She got the tzarat, and Moshe had to pray for her. So you can say, look, yes, she was punished, but still, you know, she had to clean it up. So that might be one option. Can someone have another option?
Still had the Meraglim still, maybe.
Okay, who said it?
Chuck.
So Chuck said, you know what, maybe it's Chet HaMeraglim. So that's nothing to do with Miriam because Miriam didn't participate in Chet HaMeraglim. We don't know what she said. I assume that she probably tried to support Moshe, but she didn't know what to do. But because Chet HaMeraglim created a national sin that every year we pay for it, you know, Tisha B'Av, part of Tisha B'Av is Chet HaMeraglim. So therefore, it's like Para Aduma, it's like in a very general way that we atone for everyone's sins. So the same thing, or very similar to that, is what is the idea of Mitat Miriam, the death of Miriam. Very good. So that can be the second option. So now we'll go back to our source sheet and we'll see something interesting. I'll skip the... So now, one more thing that I think it's important to know. According to Rashi, I'm not sure that chronologically is right or not, but he's trying to attach the death of Miriam to Para Aduma. Okay. Now, the Ibn Ezra says, V'tam v'yavou bnei Yisrael kol ha'eda ba'avur shemetu dor ha'midbar v'ata ba'u ha'ba'im el eretz klan. So it's like Rashi. We are talking about the end of the 40th year in the desert. Okay. So says Chizkuni, וישב העם בקדש, עמדו שם ארבעה חודשים עד חודש אב. So it says here, וישב העם בקדש, they start sitting in קדש from חודש ראשון, from ניסן, and they sat there for 4 months until Chodesh Av, Shebo Ba'u Le'or Ahar, V'sham Met Aaron. So Aaron died at the same month. Ve'ein ze Kadesh she'ne'emar alav v'teshvu be'Kadesh yamim rabim. It's not the same Kadesh where they sent the Meraglim from. She'arei oto Kadesh el paharanu, ve'nikra Kadesh Barnea, u'mimeno nishtalchu ha'meraglim. Ve'Kadesh ze she'ne'emar v'yeshev ha'am be'Kadesh. So this Kadesh is not Kadesh Barnea. It's not the place that the Meraglim were sent from. This is Kadesh in Midbar Tzin, in the desert of Tzin. שנאמר וישב הים בקדש ובמדבר צין בגבול ארץ אדום. ותם עוד שם מרים, לפי שהתחיל כבר במתי מדבר, שמח לו מיטת מרים ואהרון. This is something totally different from Rashi. According to the Chizkuni, you know why we mention here the death of Aaron and Miriam? Because this is where basically they were the last, how do you say, the Achronei HaMoakinim, the last of the Moakins? What do you call them? The Mohicans. Okay, thank you. The last of the Mohicans, which means they were the last one to remain standing, obviously Moshe later on, so they had to die. So now, wow. 1 second. There is something very interesting. If I would ask you, why is it that all the people who left Mitzrayim deserve death in the desert, I mean 20 and up, you will tell me, Cheta Meraglim, right? Good. If I would ask you, why is it that Aaron need to die and he couldn't enter the land of Israel, what would you say?
Egel Hazav.
Okay, one option can be Egel Hazav, very good.
He was involved with Moshe with striking the rock.
Okay, striking the rock, right? Yan lo emantem bilagdisheni, al ken lo teviun et ha'am hazeh. You didn't sanctify my name when you hit the rock, so therefore you cannot lead the people to Eretz Israel. Very good. I would like to suggest to you that according to the Chizkuni, that have nothing to do with any of what we said before. They had to die. That's it. Dor Yotzei Mitzrayim had to die because of Chet HaMeraglim. The only way to get out of this decree, you have two options. One, to be like a Kalev, Ruach Acheret, a different spirit, meaning you need to totally distinguish yourself and separate yourself from this generation and to stand up and to say, Yachol Nuchala, we can do it. Or to be Moshe's replacement, which is Yoshua. Everyone else, even if you are a tzaddik, even if you are the greatest person ever, you are going to die. So according to the Chizkuni, the mentioning of the death of Miriam and Aaron in this parsha is to signify the idea that the generation of Yotzei Mitzrayim, the generation of the people who left Mitzrayim are gone. That's it. And now we are starting a new generation, Dor Holech, Vedorba, meaning we have the idea that, and that's probably part of the idea that in order to allow the next generation, this generation, the leaders from the previous generation, not all of them will talk about it, will need to be gone. Now, I know that many of you know the Midrash that says that the women didn't participate in the Egel, didn't participate in the Meraglim, and they all entered the land of Israel. So, it's true, there is a Midrash like that, and perhaps he's right, and perhaps all the women came into the land of Israel and basically destroyed the balance between the genders. That's why we have 52% women, 48% men, because the women never die. So maybe. But maybe also we can say Midrashim Chalukim. You know, we don't know exactly what happened. So obviously the Midrash had an agenda, and they wanted to push the agenda. So I don't know. All the women came into Israel, maybe, maybe not, I don't know. So I cannot really answer that question of what's with all this Midrashim. So the idea of the Chizkuni, which is I think very important, is in a way it's showing that Miriam and Aaron had no choice, in a way. They couldn't do anything to allow themselves to enter the land of Israel. They all had to die as part of Yotzei Mitzrayim. So now, if we go to the Abarbanel, in the Abarbanel, we see something interesting. So until now, we don't blame anyone. We don't, we basically look at Mitat Aaron and Miriam as one of two things. It teaches us about the atonement, the idea of atonement, even though we don't exactly understand for what and how. And the second thing is to show that the generation of the desert as a whole had to die. The Abarbanel has a different take on it. He says, Aval Kadesh, Zehu Makom Acher Bemidbar Tzin. This Kadesh that we mentioned in our Pasuk is a different place in the desert of Tzin. Shebau Sham Bishnat Ha-Arba'im, that they came there on the 40th year. Umeta Sham Miriam, and Miriam died. Veba HaKatuv Lelamdeinu, Shebeyamim Mu'atim Metu Aharon U'Miriam V'Gam Moshe. They all died in the same period of time, meaning from Av to the month of Av until the month of Adar. וכמו שאמר הנביא ואחיד שלושת הרועים בירח אחד. So first and foremost, it comes to teach us that the old leadership is gone. Is gone in a spam of Av, Elul, Tishrei, Cheshvan, Kislev, Tevet, Shvat. So in Adar, in 8 months, this entire leadership is gone. וגם להודיע שבקדש ברנע הייתה תלונת וגזירת מיטה לדור המרגלים. It's come to teach you also that in קדש ברנע there was the decree against the people because of the מרגלים שלא יבואו אל הארץ. וכן בקדש הזה שהיה במדבר צין הייתה גם כן גזירה אחרת ותלונת מיטה שלא ייכנסו לארץ משה ואהרון, כאילו תמיד בקדש ברנע קצף הקדוש ברוך הוא בעמו וחסידיו. Now this is a fascinating thing what the Abarbanel says. The Abarbanel says that the word here, Bekadesh, which who cares exactly where it is, but it's come to remind you and to create this connection between this Kadesh and Kadesh Barnea, where the Meraglim were. To teach you that the death of Moshe and Aaron and Miriam, all of them, is connected to Chet HaMeraglim. And it's connected to Chet HaMeraglim in two ways. One, the fact that Moshe, Aaron, and Miriam are indirectly somehow blamed, are being blamed for Chet HaMeraglim. Because, you know, Moshe and Aaron, I mean, especially Moshe, who sent the Meraglim without consulting with God, also had a part in it, directly or indirectly. And therefore, everyone who had anything to do with Chet HaMeraglim is going to die. The second thing is that the idea when we talk about the land of Israel, we're not talking only just about the territory and about the promise. We are talking about a different hanhaga, a different leadership, different leaders. And therefore, if you are not part of the Eretz Israel leadership, you are going to stay in the desert. You are going to die. And that's why Aaron and Miriam and Moshe are dying at the end, to show you that they were not so active in Chet HaMeraglim, so therefore they didn't die, you know, at year 36 or 32, but rather on the 40th year, they continue to have some kind of life, but they had to die because they didn't adjust to the new vision of the new leadership of the new promised land, which is Eretz Israel. Before we continue, is everyone with me? Any suggestions, any ideas? Okay.
Yes, Shai?
Yes.
So in the story with the Benot Salatchad, when they made reference to their father, they said, our father died, but not as the sinners in the Midbar. So you have the whole generation that died, except, and you talk about these three leaders. So maybe they're mentioned separately because they're not connected to the Chet, that they died for other reasons, not as part of the Am and the Chet, or that they are part of the Am and the Chet. So it's like an interesting... They're separated out for a different reason.
Right. I think the two opinions will be presented in just a few minutes. The first, no, you are right. The first opinion. The first opinion that I suggested was the idea that they died because they were involved, even indirectly, with Chet HaMeraglim. We will see. Rav Shimshon Lefayadir, she's going to give us a contradicting opinion to what we said now. And that will really show the two opinions. So now let's go back here. And the Abarnel suggested also, ודיבר הכתוב בגנותם של ישראל, שבמקום שהיה להם לבוא לנוד למשה ולאהרון ולנחמם במיטת אחותם הנביאה, נקהלו עליהם לריב עמהם ולא לנחמם. וזה שאמר ויקהלו על משה ועל אהרון וירב העם ממשה, כי להיות העיקר בנבואה ובהנהגה הייתה המריבה עמו בראשונה. So says the Abarnel, that really the narrative criticized the Jewish people, that Miriam dies, and Moshe and Aaron wants to mourn and to, you know, to think about her. And then the congregation just jumps on them and demand water and all of it. Which means what we have is very interesting according to the Abarnel. You have the leaders from the past generation, they try to mourn on one of their leaders, Miriam. And the new people, they are somewhat ungrateful. Which means they are looking at Moshe and Aaron, and they basically say to themselves, you know what, I don't understand, what do they do there? Why do they sit and mourn a leader that we, you know, we don't even maybe know? You know, we want to live, we want to continue on, we are thirsty, we want water. So it's a very interesting confrontation between the old generation who wants to mourn for their leader, and then you have the new generation that has no patience for that, that they want water. So you see how the new generation is a little bit ungrateful, wants to have whatever they want, and they don't take into consideration what's happened in the past. So that's according to the Abarnel. We'll see a totally different opinion in few minutes, okay? So according to the Abarnel, he criticized the new generation, saying, you are too much in a rush to go kadima, to go further, and you don't stop for a second to pay respect for the past that you had before you. Okay, so that's the first part. Now, let's go to the second part. The second part is the following. Rav Shimshon Raphael Hirsch, beautifully written and very meaningful message. Rav Shimshon Raphael Hirsch says the following. Vatamut sham Miriam vatikaver sham. And Miriam died there and she was buried there. He siyema et shlichuta alei adamot. She completed her mission on earth. It's not because of sins. It's not because involvement directly or indirectly in chet ha-meraglim. She just completed her mission. Kivra bekadesh, her burial site in Kadesh, yodia lador acharon. It will teach or will let the last generation know. שלא הסתלקה מן העולם, עד שלא היה הדור החדש מוכן לעתיד המובטח לו. Miriam did not die until she knew that the new generation is ready. במסע הארוך, in this long journey, והעשיר בניסיונות קשים, in this long and enriched journey that was filled with very difficult trials, לא היו אנשים שותפות למעשה הבגידה בהשם. This is when someone, I think, asked me on the chat, what about the women? The women were not involved in all these actions of betrayal in God. שבאו מתוך ייאוש, because they came out of despair. בשמחת לבב הם בטחו בהשם, with their joys in their heart, they trusted God. יכלו לו בהתמסרות, they were committed to him with dedication. ולפיכך גזירת המיטה במדבר לא נגזרה על אנשים. So therefore, the decree against not going into the land of Israel was not decreed against the women, as the Midrash Rabbah says. ועתה, and now, אמאות וסבתות עמדו לעלות עם הדור החדש של הארץ המובטחת, so the mothers and the grandmothers will go and enter the land of Israel with the new generation, והם שמרו בליבם את הזיכרון החי של העבר במצרים, ושל המסע במדבר על פי השם, and they remember, and they're going to transmit the traditions of all those stories that the Jewish people had in their journey in the desert. והן יכלו להרוות את נפש הנכדים והנינים מן המעיין הרוחני של חוויותיהם עם השם, and they will be able to enrich the experience for the new generation with their stories. אכן, נשי ישראל הקדימו להצטייד ברוח ישראל והיו חדורות בה עד לעומק נפשן, the women. They were the one who equipped themselves with the spirit, with the right spirit, and they were able to instill it in their neshamot, ועובדה זו ראויה להיות נזקפת לזכותה של מרים שאירה לפניהם כנביאה. And the prototype for that woman who is able to trust God and to be able to give hope is Miriam. So now, let's stop here for just a second. And I want to, obviously, ask you a question. So I don't understand. Miriam is the prototype woman who has this trust, the Muna, and everything else, right? Wonderful. So why did she die? Why wasn't she able to go into the land of Israel? What do you think? Yes. Unmute yourself.
Is it possible that Miriam died because this is the day she was supposed to die from the day of her birth? It had nothing to do with any sin.
Okay. Who said it, Larry?
Larry, yeah.
Okay, so Larry, I think you are right, but I will expand on it. She died not because of any sins. She died because she completed her mission. What was her mission? Her mission was to always find hope in the most desperate situations. We know it from the get-go. When the decree of Pharaoh was not to have children, not to have, all the baby boys will be thrown into the river, she, according to the Midrashim, went ahead and convinced her parents to have children and to have Moshe. She was the one to vatetatzav achoto merachok ledea ma ye'aselo. She stood from afar to see what will happen with Moshe's teiva in the Nile, which means Miriam's position or mission in life was to give this tikva and bitachon. When she saw that she trained the new women, the new generation of women to do what she did, she died. Which I think that all the women in the shul needs to really send me in the chat Yishar Koach, because basically what I'm doing, I'm saying that the women were the ones to always keep the hope, and they were able to not to go into despair that caused us, the men, to do the egel, the meraglim, the complaints, everything else. Because we, men, according to Rav Shimon Raphael Hirsch, we are, when we don't see that things go our way, we go into despair. And the women are able to see above and beyond. By the way, I would just say, as a side note, the perushim of Rav Shimon Raphael Hirsch on the Chumash are basically our shiurim that he gave to women in Shabbat afternoon in Chur. So you understand why he had to flatter them. So, but you know what, why not? We can obviously steal it and say it and enjoy it. But I think, joking aside, I think he's really saying something which has tremendous importance, that I will also show you how it enriches our understanding in something else in the parsha that we'll see in a few minutes. But the idea of Rav Shimon Raphael Hirsch is that the death of Miriam is mentioned now because now it's like basically, if I built a company and I built it, and then I trained the new generation, and then I see that I can trust them and they can continue my legacy and expand it. This is the best time for the CEO to do what?
Step down.
To say goodbye, let me enjoy the company growth, and let me enjoy the young generation lead. Let me take a step back. I'm not saying to die, but with Miriam, she basically completed her mission, and she was able to really die knowing that her legacy not only is not going to die, it's going even to grow. One second, I have someone who wrote a question. A part of good leadership is to know when to pass the baton to the younger generation. Yes, that's so true, and that's one of the most difficult things. Some people don't want to let go, and some people want the company to go down when they go down, so to show that everything dependent on them. It's very difficult. Transition between generations, it's one of the most difficult things that we have in business and all sorts of other issues as well. Very good. So now, let's go continue with Rav Shimon Raphael Hirsch, and then he says, "Perek ze meta'er bikzara ובלשון פשוטה את מות אהרון ומרים, וקודם לו הפרק הגדול של פרה אדומה מלמד את תורת הישארות הנפש. אותו פרק הוא מבוא גדול למיתת הצדיקים האלה, the longevity of the נפש, the eternity of the נפש. וכך הוא מורה. מה שעשה את מרים למרים ומה שעשה את אהרון לאהרון, what made Miriam Miriam and what made Aaron Aaron, לא מת במותם. He didn't die when they died. Miriam was Miriam not only because she was alive in body. She was alive in spirit. And the same thing with Aaron. כדרך שפעילותם חיה לעד באומתם, כך עצם מהותם היא נצחית. היא עזבה עתה את הארציות בתחלוף ושבה אל השם שהוא מקור החיים. Yes, their body is gone, but their neshama is eternal. והנה אמרו חכמים, למה נשמחה מיתת מרים לפרשת פרה אדומה? לומר לך, מה פרה אדומה מחפרת, אף מיתתם של צדיקים מחפרת. ולמדנו מכאן גם אמת גדולה זו. כדרך שמצוות פרה אדומה מורה שהאדם הוא בין אל מוות ובעל חירות מוסרית, כך מיתת הצדיקים מורה על שני אלה. אכן מותו של צדיק מעיד כמאה עדים על הישארות הנפש. So he says basically, he says, just because of time, I'm going to cut it a little short, and I will say, basically he says, Rav Shimshon Raphael here says, the death of Miriam comes to teach us the idea that it's not about the body, it's about the neshama, it's about your legacy, what you created. Miriam created a new cadre of women who are able to continue on that legacy, to always be there for the people and to inject hope and vision to a nation that sometimes easy to fall into despair and do stupid things. So the Miriam was able to ensure the future of the Jewish people, and then her body left, but the neshama stayed. So the idea of the death of Miriam in our parasha has nothing to do with Chet HaMeraglim, exactly the opposite. She was able to save the women from Chet HaMeraglim. So she died here knowing that she completed her mission. Now, we will see something which is fascinating, in my opinion. To some extent, it's even a little bit insensitive. But I'll share it with you, and I'll ask you, what do you think? In Yalkut Shimoni, which is a very late Midrash, it's not like the Midrashim we learn on Thursday night, even though Bamidbar Rabbah is also a late Midrash, but Yalkut Shimoni is even later than that. And it says the following. הבאר היה עולה בזכות מרים, שנאמר ותמות שם מרים. So the באר, that's based on what the other Midrashim says, that the well that the Jewish people had was because of Miriam. And then when Miriam died, מיד לא היה מים לעדה. There was no water for the congregation. וכיוון שנסתלק הבאר, and after the באר was gone, התחילו מתכנסים על משה ועל אהרון. So the people came and gathered and start complaining. שנאמר ויקהלו על משה ועל אהרון, והיה משה ואהרון יושבים ומתאבלים על מרים. So Moshe and Aaron are mourning for Miriam, for the death of their sister, and the Jewish people are coming, you know, and they want water. So the Abarbanel, if you remember, the Abarbanel said that that was criticism on the Jewish people. The Yalkut Shimoni says, no, that's not true. אמר להם הקדוש ברוך הוא, בשביל שאתם אבלים ימותו בצמה, עמוד וכך מתחה והשקית את העדה ואת בעירם. Do you hear what this Midrash says? The Midrash says that God criticized Moshe and Aaron, telling them, stop it. Stop mourning for your sister. You have the congregation here. They are all thirsty. You know, they didn't drink for an hour. You should stand up, leave your sister alone, and go ahead and give water to the people. How can we understand something like that? That sounds so insensitive. What do you think?
It reminds me of the Maamar Chazal, Eis Latzos Lashem Heferu Toratecha.
Okay, Rabbi Linzer, so that's true to some extent. Sometimes you need to leave something in order to do something else. But here, you know, give them a break. Their sister, who really was responsible for Moshe's birth, was very close with Aaron. You know, give them a few hours to mourn for their sister, and then, you know, go ahead and give some water to the congregation. What is it? Look at the language. Bishvil she'atem avelim. Yamutu batzama, because you are mourners, they need to die. What is the criticism on Moshe and Aaron?
That in my view, they're looking backwards all the time. Moshe and Aaron. They've lost all the Yotzei Mitzrayim. They're the last, as you put it before, the last of the Mohawks. Okay, but their philosophy is looking backwards and not to the future.
Yafe meod. I think exactly like that. And I think that the idea is that Hashem says to Moshe, what are you doing? She died. And it's Rabshim Shonafah and Rish, her body died, but her neshama is there. What is the Miriam's mission in life? To give hope, to give life. So you are sitting with her thinking that you are doing the right thing, and my people are dying out of thirst. So you think that you respect Miriam, that you honor her memory? Exactly the opposite. You are disgracing her memory. You are looking backward instead of looking forward. By the way, this is another proof that Moshe and Aaron lost it in terms of the new leadership. They are looking backwards and they are not looking forward. And so that's one opinion in the Midrash. The second opinion in the Midrash is even stronger than that. Davar acher, lama nistaleka be'er b'mitat Miriam? So why is it that their well disappeared when Miriam died? Kedei sheyedu hakol, so everyone will know, kama hayta tzadeket. So everyone will know how righteous she was, v'yitztaru aleha rabim, and everyone will be very sorry about her. V'gmelu ita chesed, and they will show compassion towards her. Kach kevan shemeta Miriam u'Moshe ve'Aaron asukim ba. So Miriam died, and Moshe and Aaron are dealing with Miriam. V'Yisrael mevakshim ayin, ve'ein motzim miyad nitkansu aleim. So the people were looking for water because their leaders are sitting in a corner crying for their sister. So there is no leadership. Meaning the people are looking for water. The two main leaders are sitting in the corner and there is no one there. Can you imagine that? Kevan shera'u otam ba'im. So the people saw Moshe and Aaron in the corner, so they start moving towards them. Kevan shera'u otam ba'im, amar Moshe le'Aaron, tomar ma'u kinuze. So Moshe says to Aaron, what do you think? Why are they coming? Amar le'Aaron lo bnei Avraham, Yitzchak v'Yaakov, em gomle chasadim, bnei gomle chasadim. So Aaron, who is such a... He sometimes says such a naive character in the Midrashim, says to Moshe, obviously, you know, they come to offer condolences, they come to visit in a Shiva house, they probably, you know, maybe some of them are like, you know, casserole ladies, you know, that they bring food, you know, it's all nice. They come to obviously comfort us. Amar le Moshe le Aaron, I ata yodea lafrish ben kinus le kinus. Ein ze kinus shel takana, ela shel kalkala. Says, Moshe says to Aaron, my dear brother, you are too naive. Don't you see they are coming to complain? They are not coming to visit us in the Shiva house. Okay, they're going to complain. Why? She'ilu haya kinus shel takana, because if it was a proper gathering, if they really will come to comfort us, hayu tzrichim liyot berosham sarei alafim v'sarei meot. They will come properly. They will come formally. They will come with the ministers of thousands and hundreds and everything else. V'ata omer ligmol chesed en bayim. You think they are coming to show compassion to us? No, they are coming to complain. Miyad itichu dvarim kenegdo. So immediately the Jewish people start complaining. So you would think that the Midrash will criticize it. Take a look. Amar lahem HaKadosh Baruch Hu lemeshartei tzibur. Su'u mikan bimheira. Banai metim batzama ve'atem yoshvim u'mitablim al hazkena. Wow. Harsh, huh? Tough. There is no criticism on the Jewish people. This is amazing. You, Moshe and Aaron, you mourn for the Zkena. Now, the word Zkena, it's not to degrade Miriam. It's like the old generation, stop with that. You have a new generation that you need to take care of. They need to have water. They need to live. They need to have future. You can't be stuck in the past and basically prevent the future from growth. Meaning the idea is, and that's what we're going to obviously push for, you need to find the balance between the past and the future. You need to have a connection. By the way, what the people did is obviously insensitive. They could have accomplished their mission of having water and be a little bit more sensitive to Moshe and Aaron. But that's part of the younger generation. You know, they think that the world was created for them and the world started with them, okay? And there is a reason for that. It's good. But they need to sometimes be taught about, you know, binu shno dor vador. So for the future, the generation of the future, they need to have a little bit of criticism, look at the past. But the past generation need to have a tremendous criticism to stop thinking only about the past and not pass over their past and start thinking about the future generation. So the idea of the Yalkut Shimoni, which is so insightful, it is so meaningful, is that Moshe and Aaron just couldn't let go of the past. They couldn't bring themselves to the idea that there is a new generation, there is new leadership, there is new techniques to teach them and to talk to them. And the idea is that you are not equipped anymore to lead this generation. And that's what Moshe and Aaron are being told by God. Meshartei Tzibur, you are still their servants. You are still their leaders. You need to do something about it. Jacques, please. I think you raised your hand. I think it says you raised your hand.
I think it was easy for Moshe to be a leader because he always turned around and asked for direction from Hashem. So finally, he's finally faced with a serious challenge. And he sits there sitting Shiva. Why? Because he expects Hashem to help him out. And Hashem turns around and says, hey, don't look at me anymore. Because it's an old style leadership. But it's even worse than that. I really think, you know, we always talk about Moshe being the greatest Navi and our leader. It was easy when you had Hashem for 40 years next to you.
I will take one thing. Easy with Jewish people for 40 years, it's never easy, even when God do things for you, okay? But I agree with the idea that Moshe's represented a leadership of miracles, of God, of divinity. And yes, you know, we see, for example, on Kriyat Yamsuf, when there is the Egyptians from here and the Yam is from here, and Moshe cry out to God. And Hashem says to him, well, what are you crying out to me? Go, move. Meaning do things. And the new generation, there is a risk there. You know, sometimes you move too fast and you forget God. That's obviously the risk in living in Eretz Israel. We need to always find this balance. And I think the Torah tried to present these two extreme descriptions of what's happened when you are stuck in the past and what's happened when you are too obsessed and focused on only on the future. The idea of Judaism is to try to tie all time dimensions to one. I see two participants raise hands. So, Paul, okay.
We have the same idea in Ve'et Hanan. When Hashem says to Moshe, Rav lecha, al tosif ledaber elai od bedavar hazeh. That he's angry with him, that he's still hankering of what he knows he can't have.
Agree. Yeah. That will be a little bit of a different show just about Moshe's leadership. We'll do it maybe once a different time. Who else? Phil. Phil.
Did Miriam have family?
Wow. Yes. Hur, who was assassinated at Chet HaEgel, was Miriam's son. Now, who exactly was her husband and did she have more children? I don't know. But we know about one son, Hur, Benash and Miriam.
The issue of the women going into the chosen country, I mean, who did they marry?
Yeah, so don't forget, Phil, that was the good old times. You can have more than one wife.
There, but for the grace of God.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that was good old times or bad old times, but the idea is that obviously you can have more than one woman, so more than one wife. So that's I guess how they got married somehow.
Thank you.
But Bichlal, this idea is, I don't know, it's a little hard to understand. You're talking about, you know, if all the time, let's say it was 50-50 in terms of genders. So you're talking about everyone who was under the age of 20, everyone who was born in the desert, and all the women who were, you know, one day old when they left Egypt to 40 years old. I don't know, it's amount of people that it's really a huge amount of people. So I don't know exactly how they did it, but whatever. I don't have an answer for those numbers. Okay, so now, any other questions?
Yeah, I just...
Yes.
In Zahut of Miriam, it would have been nice if the well could have continued after her Shiva, because it was so stumped. She did so much and she deserved more, just a little bit longer so that her Shiva could be finished and then the well could have maybe dried up. That would have been...
Okay. So the question is, you know, what do you want from Moshe now? Let them sit Shiva. You know, there's no Shiva, but let them sit a day or two. Let them mourn and then they will do it. No, the thing is, And that's why it's connected so much to Rav Shimshon Raphael Hirsch. Miriam would not want it. Miriam wants you to focus on the new generation. Don't focus on the grief now, because I died. My body is gone, but my neshama is here. And my neshama has a mission. The mission is to equip the new generation with the kelim, with the instruments, to deal with the challenges of the future. And that's what you need to do as leaders. And I think that's where the criticism is really there. So now let's go back to here. And I want to show you one more thing about the new generation. And we will try to wrap it up. It says, וידבר העם באלוקים ובמשה, למה אליתונו ממצרים למות במדבר, כי אין לחם ואין מים ונפשנו קצה בלחם הקלוקת. So we all know the complaint about the bread and the water and the manna and the man. The Jewish people had enough of that. That's the new generation. So says Rashi, ונפשנו קצה, אף זה לשון קיצור נפש ומיאוס. Okay, so they are disgusted by that. They don't want it anymore. They have enough. What is lechem klokel? לפי שהמן נבלה באיברים קראו קלוקל. The man had this nature that it will be swallowed into your organs. You will not need to go to the bathroom. אמרו, עתיד המן הזה שיתפח במעינו. כלום יש ילוד אישה שמכניס ואינו מוציא. He says, this man is going to explode our bellies. It's impossible that the man will go in and will never go out. So that's why they call it lechem klokel. So now I want to ask you a question. What is the nekuda, the point of their complaint? What exactly, precisely, was their complaint? The new generation. For 40 years, an entire generation ate manna, and they didn't die because of GI issues, okay? They died because of chet ha-meraglim, not because of GI issues that were caused by man. So what's the problem of this new generation with the man? What's their issue?
They want to run their own lives. They want to get on with it.
Little, just define it, clarify it better.
They want independence. They want to take a responsibility, and they don't want to rely on the nisim of man and what.
They don't want leaders who lead by miracles, and they don't want to be sustained by miracles. They want to have normal life. Now, by the way, we can obviously see it from two perspectives. One is wonderful, and the other one is, they just don't want miracles because they don't want to have any feelings of gratitude to Hashem or to be connected to Hashem. They want to have only natural life, and it might be. We don't know. So the idea is that they are not saying that, you know, the man is not tasty, it was not cooked right, you know, there is not enough variety on the menu. That's not the issue. The issue, according to Rashi, is we don't want a miracle bread. We want normalcy. We want a normal bread that we can eat and we go to the bathroom. So then, according to... you know what? I'll go to Rashar Hirsch. Because again, the Rashar Hirsch says something very interesting. He says, "Ki ein lechem ve'ein mayim, ye efshar she'ta'anu she'ein lahem ha'mazon ha'darush." It's impossible to say that they complain that they don't have food. Sharei hem odim miyad sheyesh lahem lechem, because they admit that there is bread. It's called lechem klokel. Ach hem hayu chaserim ma'achal u'mishteh kederech habriyot. They were lacking food and drinks like all other human beings. Hem kiblu et shnei ele belo amal ki im bederech nes. V'davar zeh esev lahem shi'amum. This is amazing. The older generation, the past generation, they were very happy to receive the man, you know, next to their tent. They were not bored. This new generation, it's boring. We want to do something in order to accomplish it. Do you see the difference in nature, in character, in aspirations between Dor HaMidbar, the generation of the desert, and the generation of the people who are about to go into the land of Israel? Just totally two different people, different mindsets. It's boring. To get the manna every day, to do the same ritual every day, it's boring. Give me something to do. I would like to participate. I would like to be engaged. I would like to do something. Chesed Hashem, שהנהיג אותם יום יום בהשגחה מיוחדת זה 40 שנה היה להם לשגרה. It became a routine. ובכעסם שללו שלא בצדק גם את ערכו התזונתי של המן. So Rav Shimshon Refaneer says, I don't criticize their approach. I criticize their lack of gratitude. And this is something that I think it's so relevant. When a younger generation, when the new generation demands something, wants something, there is a lot of truth in what they say. But sometimes when they, because they come so harsh and they come with this revolutionary mindset, they are sometimes showing ungratefulness or they criticize things that are not, do not deserve that criticism or anger. And I think I don't want to, obviously go to politics here or anything else, but we all know that, there are certain things that needs to change in, in police work, in government work, in institutional work. But there is a way to do it. There is need to be someone who is level-headed and can analyze and to say, okay, this deserves criticism. This is good. This can be improved. Not that everything is terrible or everything is great, and this is sometimes the conversation between the older generation and the younger generation. The older generation says, oh, everything was wonderful in our time and here it's terrible. And the younger generation says, oh, everything that was in your time was horrible. We discovered America, okay? We are the ones that invented the universe. And the idea that we are trying to push is integration, which is one of the most difficult things to do, is how do you integrate both worlds into one? You take the good things from the past, you throw the bad things, you integrate it into the future in order to really build a strong future. Someone raised his hand. I don't know. I don't see who raised his hand. Thank Whoever you. Raised his hand, please unmute yourself.
Yes. Can I speak?
Sure. Fagi, please unmute.
Your conclusion was very interesting and right on, but it's also interesting to note that perhaps the desire for independence is innate because this is a generation that was born in the desert. How did they know about what you expressed that they might be thinking and talking about? They only experienced the miracles and having everything given to them. How did they have any idea what being on their own would be like?
Very good question. So the answer for that, even though I'm not an archaeologist, but we know for sure, especially from our parsha, that they communicated with other tribes. They communicated with other people who moved through the desert. I mean, the Jewish people were not the only ones moving through the desert. And we also know they send, emissaries to Edom, to Moab, and saying, we would like to go through your country. We're going to buy bread. We're going to buy water, which means they understood. And I'm sure, by the way, there was some kind of trade between the Jewish people. And after they killed the Midianites, they took all their, they saw how other people live their lives. So my opinion is, and I think it's also substantiated by some archaeologists and some biblical scholars, that there was trade between the Jewish people and the other tribes around them.
Very interesting. Thank you.
My pleasure. Someone else?
Jacques? Yeah, Jacques. Speaking as a representative, most of us of the older generation, we can be tough also. In other words, I'm not sure if had I been a member of the younger generation, that I would have wanted to come up for 40 years against Moshe and Aaron, who always pulled the trump card, and they were running it. So I think, in a sense, it's not only that we remember it was good in the old times and we opposed, we were running the show. And that can be hard, that can be tough as well.
Agree. I said this is one of the most difficult things to do. How do you pass the baton? How do you, train the new generation? How do you educate them? How do you inspire them? When do you give them responsibilities? How many responsibilities? What should they do? How do you basically integrate them into the older generation leadership and then, groom them? Is that your responsibility? There are so many different questions that we deal with that it's not easy. One thing for sure, you cannot start that process if you are what we call in Hebrew, ochez bekarnot ha-mizbeach. If you hold on and you don't let go, there is need to be a let go to some extent. You know, you hear, it's so subjective. You know, some people say, oh, ani zorek et ha-maftechot, I throw the keys, or I throw the towel, as they say in the NBA, you know. This is also not the right way. There is need to be a process. There is need to be a lot of thinking of how you do it. And this is so relevant to us. It's in leadership. It's in family. You know, even in family life, there is so many questions. So when do you allow, you know, it's your children, but when do you allow the new generation to lead or to be part of the leadership of the family, to make decisions, financial decisions, family decisions, religious decisions? There are so many things. And I think this parsha really touches the core issue. And we see the mistakes that both generations do. Let me see. One second, there is a chat. They were bored with their routine of an unchanging diet. The first generation saw that happen to the Mitlonim and learned their lesson to some extent. Okay, so now let's see the last source here. Rabbeinu Bechaye just said one thing that I want us to look at. He says, "Aval anu ikar kol anagotenu ma'achalenu mishtenu b'inyan mechudash ki ein lanu lechem b'yom echad leyamim arbe, ki sh'ar ha'omot shenafsham sve'a besipuk ha'mazon, sheroim ben yedeem v'imaem, ve'enenu imanu ki im dvaryom b'yomo." So basically, their complaint is, we don't want to be so dependent on God, which is where the mistake is. You know, this is where the issue can come up with. The new generation says, we want our bread, we make it so we can freeze it, we can have it, you know, in our basement, we can have it in our refrigerator, so we can have it. We don't need to be rely on God on a daily basis all the time. And in a way, that's the risk of coming into the land of Israel. And I think that's what the Torah is trying to show us. On one hand, we want people to be independent. We want people to be involved, to be engaged, to be active, to be productive, to be innovative. But at the same time, v'ram levavcha v'shachachta. It makes you hardy, and then you will forget God. So basically, what I want to claim today is a few things. Is to first and foremost to talk about Miriam, and to talk about the fact that she was really one of the greatest leaders, and the greatness of a leader is being tested to some extent. Not only when he or she were alive, but even more than that, how their legacy was perpetuated in future generations. And especially according to Rashar Hirsch, the uniqueness of Miriam was that she passed away when she felt that she completed her mission. That when she realized that the new generation, the new cadre of leaders, are going to be able to continue on their legacy and to teach and enrich the experience of the new generation. And that was really the women. So that's one part. The second part is the understanding of transmission in terms of generation, the transformation of generations. How do you equip and train and educate the new generation? How do you try to balance between the desires, the wants, the history, the future of all people? And how do you ensure the fact that the transmission is as smooth as you can in order to secure the future generation going into the land of Israel and not repeating the same mistakes that you did, and God forbid, being punished? So I think this is the idea of our parsha, which obviously is very relevant, I think, to our lives. And it requires a lot of flexibility, humility, and vision. I think, you know, part of the idea of what distinguishes a leader, a CEO, let's say, from a CFO or from a manager is the vision. It's the ability to see and to get the buy-in from everyone to that vision. That's really the purpose of a leader. The leader does not need to, you know, walk the machine so well. He needs to have a vision of how everyone can contribute his or her talent, how to create, you know, to create a connection between the past and the future in order to really secure the success of the enterprise. So that's for today. Any questions? So if not, I'm
Yishkoach. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
My pleasure. Everyone, have a wonderful and safe and a healthy day. Be careful, please. And Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat.